We are in today in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning with verse 18. Okay. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things, and the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. And so, there's a difference, as we're talking here, in this scripture. It talks about how the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but for those who are being saved, it is the power of God. And it goes on to talk about wisdom. Knowledge is a great thing to have. Information gathered is information gathered from school, or, you know, even nowadays they say that we are no longer in the industrial age, but we are in the information age. It's easy to get lots of information. And so knowledge is basically book smarts, but wisdom is the soundness of an action or decision with regard to the application of experience, knowledge, and good judgment. So as I was telling the children earlier, it's good to have both. It's good to be very knowledgeable about things, but in life, it's not enough. Sometimes we talk about someone who has book smarts, but they don't have street smarts. They need to have that wisdom of how to act, how to apply the knowledge, how to apply their experiences, and use discernment to do that in the best way. I was reading the other day the tale of the men of Gotham. Now, it's not the Gotham of Batman, but it's the Gotham in Nottinghamshire, England. And it's a tale about King John wanting to come and visit them. He was King John was the king of England from 1199 to 1216. He was one of the meanest kings that Britain ever had, and he's the one that they forced to sign the Magna Carta. But in this tale, he's coming. He's talking about coming to Gotham, and the people of Gotham are thinking, oh, you know, when the king comes, they always prepare the way for the king. That reminds me of John the Baptist, right? Talking about prepare the way for Jesus Christ to come. And that was something people could relate to, because whenever the king, even in biblical times, was coming, they would make sure the roads were good. And they were talking about, in this tale, really fixing up every road that the king went on, because people didn't see the king very often. And they wanted to make sure the roads were good. So they're going to really make a nice path for the king to go to Gotham. And the people of the town, they didn't like outsiders. They didn't want a lot of people coming through their town. They liked being out in the outskirts. And so they said, we have to come up with a plan that King John won't come to our village. So they decided to act like imbeciles. When the messengers for King John came, he found them trying to drown an eel. He found them as a bird had landed on a bush, they were trying to fence it in with a fence to capture it. Of course, a bird could fly away, right? There was a huge barn that they were dragging carts to pile up and protect the barn from the heat of the sun. And they were rolling cheeses down, the round cheese down a hill, hoping it would make it to the marketplace. And the king's representative saw all this. They went back to the king. They said, those people are complete idiots. You would not believe the stupid stuff that they were doing. And the king decided to not visit the town and build his hunting lodge somewhere else. And so the people were saved. Now, they were very wise, weren't they? They were using knowledge, they were using wisdom. And there's so many times in our life experiences where we really need to be able to make good decisions, and we ask the Lord for wisdom in doing that. And we were talking about that today at Bible study, how it says in James chapter 1, you know, if you are anyone lacking in wisdom, ask the Lord to give you the wisdom. It says that in the Bible. And that's a promise that is given there, that we can find wisdom in that way. The common consensus in the world of Paul's days, he's writing this, is that God exists. You know, to the Jews, they would say, we know who God is. And we hope that the whole world can discover who God is too, just as we do today. To the Greeks, they floundered around to try to find out who God is, and they tried to discover God through knowledge. And a lot of times they would seek knowing more about God through Homer's poetry and through people who are eloquent speakers. But for Christianity, it wasn't so much the eloquence of the speech as the power of the Holy Spirit that was spoken through those words. To the Greeks, it seemed kind of crazy, because to them, you found God through wisdom. But it's interesting that to the Greeks and to the Jews, both of them would say that God exists. Nowadays, there are many who are atheists who say, you know, they don't think God exists. There are some who are searching and not knowing where to look. And I know that this is our work as the people of God to tell everyone that we know about our experience with God and our relationship with Him, to give our testimony of who He is as we go through this life. You know, sometimes people even say, they oscillate between saying, there is no God, to saying all roads lead to God. And you know, that sounds nice. It sounds very politically correct, but it's not true. In John 14:6, Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So there's only one way to get to the Father. You know, we were talking about Billy Graham earlier in the prayer requests, as he's passed away. On February 21st, 2018, I had the privilege of meeting with Billy Graham, and getting to know Beverly Shea, the one who sings with him, with that very deep voice that he would sing, a very pleasing voice that he had. And Billy Graham had a very pleasing voice too. What an amazing thing to do with your life, to be spending your whole life reaching out to so many people. Billy Graham said that he was amazed in his lifetime that he was able to meet so many people, and so many people from different countries, because he'd been to just about every country you can imagine on this earth. Billy Graham's been there, and he didn't just go there to say hi to people. He would do his crusades wherever he went and affected so many people's lives. And I remember, because I helped with three of his crusades, and that was about 25 years ago. At the last one I'd been to, he said, "I don't know how much longer I'll be able to preach. This may be the last time." He said that 25 years ago. He said, "This may be the last time. But one thing I really want to say is, don't be ashamed of the blood of Jesus Christ." Because we talk about the cross, and we talk about the body, and we talk about the blood of Christ. And the blood of Christ, it says in the Bible, it washes away our sins and makes us white as snow, right? And we sing that song. And he said, you know, we have so often the cross displayed. But he said, let's not be ashamed of talking about the blood of Christ. And I have a couple of verses here from the Bible I chose. 1 Corinthians 10:16. "Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ?" And we'll be doing that today in communion. 1 Peter 1:18 through 20, "For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake."